So to conclude, I've treated three issues that are presented as challenges to the traditional evolutionary synthesis. And first, with respect to the existence of genetic constraints that may affect evolution, I think that Gould and others were right, but the architects of the synthesis to some extent anticipated them, and I think we are rediscovering in modern terms some of what they may have already been thinking before Zwickel came along. Secondly, Eldridge and Gould presented what they call phyletic gradualism as a portrait of the synthetic theory that they wanted to replace with punctuated equilibrium, in which importance seems not to have been demonstrated. At this point, I think we have a few reasonably convincing examples in which evolution may have happened in part by genetic assimilation or involvement in fact. But I also don't think that that is a major departure from the traditional theory. I think it fits nicely within the standard population genetic framework. And I would be very interested if any of you would like to challenge any of my suggestions and conclusions. Thank you very much for your attention.
And then it's just mostly because of our incapacity to track those changes. So what would be your recommendation for to study like long-lived organisms? Is it a problem of theory or is it just a problem of that we don't have enough evidence to see that changes in morphology or genetics can happen really quickly? So is it a historical problem or is it really a lack of theory behind it?
Maybe I'm not quite sure of what you were saying about long-lived type organisms. Are you saying that the problem is that we find a difficulty to determine if changes are genetic or plastic? Is that the problem? No.
Yeah, because we can look at that kind of changes in time which are subtilar or organisms that have lived like lower generation times. But when we talk about birds or elephants, speciation and plasticity take a long time.
Right.
So for those kind of organisms, what would be your recommendation to do long-term studies or just to look at?
The problem, of course, is that for almost any kind of question that we pose, some organisms are suitable for answering it and some are not. And the problem of distinguishing genetic differences in time or in space just among individuals, the problem of distinguishing genetic differences from non-genetic differences induced by environment is, of course, a very difficult one. And that is why it usually requires some kind of breeding scheme, perhaps a common garden in which you raise individuals from different phenotypes under the same conditions, perhaps by doing crosses. Now, in the case of very long-lived organisms, like elephants or trees or tortoises, this simply is not feasible. And I think we simply have to say that we cannot be absolutely sure that the differences that we are seeing are evolved differences rather than plastic. I would say, however, that the assumption that differences between different species of the two different species or three different species of elephants, differences between different species of palms, and other long-lived organisms. Most of those morphological differences are almost certainly primarily genetically based differences rather than plastic. And And why do I say that? Because of these characteristics, which taxonomists have used for hundreds of years to distinguish species and to name species, these are characteristics which are manifested by individuals that have developed under a wide range of ecological circumstances in nature. So not all members of one species of palm grow under exactly the same soil conditions or exactly the same water conditions or temperatures or shade or sun. There is variation, and as a consequence of that variation, very often people who are familiar with these organisms, taxonomists or ecologists, they have just from the variation they see in the field, they often have a strong feeling, shall we say, of whether the characteristics are very malleable, very easily plastically changed by environment, or whether they are so consistent as to be probably genetically based. And I think in most cases they are very close to being correct. I hope that helps.
Okay, I have another question. Some people have suggested that another process to understand the observation that close relatives are similar is due to stabilizing selection. And now that I heard your explanation that it might be because of genetic constraints on phenotypic evolution, I was wondering what do you think, if there are any links between stabilizing selection and genetic constraints on adaptive, on phenotypic evolution, or if you think the two might be like exclusive processes explaining the patterns they alternate on service.
That's a very good question, of course, to make room on. And I can very easily imagine that they act together under some circumstances. Because of course, why is there stabilizing selection? And as people such as Richard Lewington have been emphasizing, this is partly owing to the organism itself, which restricts itself to a particular kind of habitat or restricts itself to certain selective pressures. In the case of animals, this is obvious just from habitat selection, that is from active behavioral choice of habitat or food, or many other environmental variables. And so then you have to ask, well, if there is an internal property of the organism, such as its behavior, which restricts it to a certain kind of environment, and thereby creates stabilizing selection for the characteristics which are suited to that environment, then you must ask why there is not a more rapid evolution of the habitat selection behavior, or whatever it is which the organism is using to restrict its milieu, its environment. And so so you may push the problem then back just a little bit to ask if there are some kinds of constraints that we need to understand on what it is that is restraining a species to remain, or a lineage of people, a group of closely related species, to stay within one particular kind of environment. I imagine that in many cases we'll conclude that there is a certain amount of stabilizing selection, a certain amount of genetic constraint, and then, but to understand the interaction between them would be even more of a challenge.
Presentado para que aún no hayan podido
elevado. De pronto se ha, también yo muchos estudios actualmente están haciendo sobre investigación, cierto, el surgimiento de nuevas especies, pero de pronto todavía no se ha logrado evidenciar mediante casos puntuales cómo podría surgir un tal son más allá del pez.
Taxonomists, by systematists, to name certain branches in the phylogeny.